In this section, we're going to look at a sampling distribution of means. What we're looking for here is creating a bell-shaped curve that tells us how do means behave. If we know a certain sample size and we collect a sample average, where is that going to land based on what we expect to happen? Something that we want to come through here, because we eventually want to find probabilities and cutoff values, what we need are normal distributions. We want these nice bell-shaped curves coming out. So before we can just jump in and start calculating, we need to know what makes it bell-shaped. If we collect these sample averages, how do we know we're going to get a normal distribution? And basically what we want to avoid is anything skewed or bimodal or basically anything that's not a bell-shaped curve. So what we're going to do in this video is just look at a simulation. So we're going to look at a sampling distribution of means, but we're going to use a website for a simulation. So for this portion, we're just gathering information. You won't have to do these calculations yourself. We just want to explore what happens when you change the population data, means, things like that. So we're going to use this website. And what it has here in the top window is parent population data. What that means is that this is our population data. That's everything. So they collected all the information, and what we can see is that there's a mean of 16. They also have a median of 16 and a standard deviation of 5. And basically when we collect all of our data, it looks like this nice bell-shaped curve. So we're just gonna fill out for parent population. That's representing population data, which means we have all of the data. So what we want to do with this population data is investigate what does it look like if we take averages from this data. What if we collected a random sample and collected the mean? So what that's going to look like is we're going to run through this animation. I'm going to go ahead and work with a sample size of 25. And if we watch this animation here, what it's doing is it's grabbing 25 data values from our population. And since our population is this bell-shaped curve, it does work in the idea that it's more likely to grab from the middle of the curve. However, like we got one dot on this lower end, it is possible to get these lower values. It's just less likely. We can see more of the stacking and repeats happen closer to the middle of the bell-shaped curve. So this sample data window here, we can see it says reps 25, which represents our sample size that we collected. And so there are these 25 data values right here. So for the sample data window, that is just randomly, or let's say a random sample from the population. And for us, we're using a sample size of 25. So that sample data window is just a single random sample that we're seeing there. Then when we ran that simulation, a little blue block fell down. So down here, it's called the distribution of means, n equals 25. What it did is it took that sample data and it calculated the average. So it basically got an X bar value, and that's what's being plotted down here. That blue dot is our X bar value. So if I ran this again and it collects 25 random values, we're gonna get a slightly different sample here. But again, most of the values coming from the middle, maybe a few on the outskirts there, and we get another sample mean. So what we're doing here in the distribution of means window is we're collecting sample means. Meaning we're getting these different X bar values from these different samples that we can collect. And we should attach our sample size because we'll talk about how that makes a difference in the end. So those are our three windows that we're working with. It's this kind of building from given everything, what if we take a random sample and from that random sample, collect X bar, collect the sample mean. So if I did this again, you know, just create a sample of 25 values, take that mean, and then we'll drop down another little blue box down here. Oh boy, that's, whoa. All right, there we go. And right now they're really stacking up on each other, but what we want to do is analyze how do the values fall through here. So right now I don't have enough to go on. So what I'm going to do is click this handy dandy 100,000 button. What that's going to do is collect 100,000 samples. So instead of doing this animated each time and showing the collection of 25, like if I collected five, if I press five there, it just collected five sample means. If I collect 10,000, it just made 10,000 sample values, and 100,000. So now you can see on this left-hand side where it says reps, I have 110,008 values for my distribution of means. Essentially, there's 110,008 X bar values in here. So we collected all of those samples and collected all their means, and that's what we're seeing in this blue distribution. So what we want to do is compare the statistics that we're seeing, and specifically the mean. So we can do is you see there's this mean up here in the parent population window. There's also a mean down here in the distribution of means. And these are slightly different. The one in the parent population window, we've seen this before. You have population data, you take the mean. So that would be our population mean. So in that parent population window, that's showing that our mean, we would be using our symbol mu to represent population mean. Now, when we look at the distribution of means window, it's a little different. So we do want to get to this idea that we've collected the means of everything, meaning what if we took infinitely many samples from this population, how are the means behaving? So it is going to relate to a population mean, but we add a little subscript to say what we're taking the average of, and what we're taking the mean of is actually of a bunch of sample means. I know this gets kind of confusing because it does end up being this kind of mean of the means, but it's that we have this distribution that's being made up of all of these X bar values. So if you imagine we have these over 110,000 X bar values, where we have all these numbers, we're taking the average of those numbers. So the little subscript we add here is of an X bar, and this is representing the average of the sample means. And when we get to a large sample size, like we're at 110,000, I mean, I could keep pushing that button and making a larger and larger sample size. The things aren't going to change all that much. It is this kind of population average of the sample means. Now, we want to be sure we use these symbols differently because it tells us what is the actual distribution we're using. So when we just have population data, it's just mu. But if it's this distribution of the means, we need that little subscript of X bar. So I already clicked the button that took a bunch of samples. It even says 110,000 there, but I took 100,000. More samples, the better. So what we want to do is compare how does the parent population compare to our distribution of means. So what we can see on that website is we started with a bell-shaped curve. And this distribution of means, this is also bell-shaped. And like I said at the beginning of the video, that's exactly what we want to see for a distribution of means. Because if we know that it's bell-shaped, then all we need is a mean and a standard deviation. And we can do everything we've been doing with GeoGebra in terms of calculating probabilities or finding cutoff values. So the shape is normally distributed. If we compare the means of the different distributions, the mean of the parent population is 16. When we get the distribution of means, it's also 16. Meaning the average for the individual data values, that's what we expect to come out most often. I mean, whenever I take a random sample here of 25 values, if it's a random sample coming from a large sample size, which 25 is kind of on the edge of what would be considered large enough, but if we're taking large random samples from our population, the mean we should get out most often should be close to 16. I mean, we end up with a bell-shaped curve because 16 will come up most often or really close to 16, but sure, we'll have a few weird samples that give us a mean a little bit larger and a mean a little bit lower, but overall we expect to be really close to 16. So that's why if we have these individual data values for the distribution of means, we expect the average to be 16. So the punchline is, if you know your population mean, that's going to be the same thing as the mean of your distribution of means. So, the means are the same. Meaning, if you have your population mean, that means you automatically have an estimate for this average of the sample means. Now let's look at our standard deviation. We started with a standard deviation of 5. Now we have a standard deviation of 1.01. And pretty much every time you make a distribution of means, your standard deviation is going to be smaller. And it's because where a population is just individual values can have a lot of variability to them. I mean, if you think about collecting the heights of students at PCC, we're going to have a wide range of heights. You can have very tall students, very short students. And with that, individually, we can have a lot of variability. But as soon as we collect a sample and take an average, so if I said go out there and talk to 30 students and take their average height, when you average, those extreme values aren't as evident. They're basically averaged out, so everything gets pulled to the middle of the distribution. So when you take averages, that's how we're ending up so close to 16 here, is that even though we're seeing these small and large values that are a little extreme, they average out and sends us close to the middle. So the standard deviation will be small. And when we take averages, the extreme values aren't as effective. So with that, they get averaged out. What we could think about though is, what if we used a smaller sample size? If we use a smaller sample size, say we did an extreme of n equals 5. So what it comes down to is, I imagine it as a game of tug of war. When you take this sample down and calculate the average, you could have extreme low values, you could have extreme high values, but say we have one or two extreme values. Well, in a sample size of 25, it's like playing a game of tug of war of two people against 23 people, and the 23 people are gonna win and pull it back to where it should be. However, if we change our sample size, so we keep this bell-shaped distribution, if I take a sample size of 5, the game of tug-of-war changes. Now if we have kind of these two extreme values, now there's only 3, and all the win, it's not as strong. So what we'll see, if we take a bunch of samples, this distribution mean should be very close to 16. The standard deviation is a little bit larger than we saw before, and you can even see it from the graph that it's more spread out on this number line. We have this kind of wider normal distribution. It's because if we get these extreme values, their pull is stronger. They don't have a big enough team to go against when playing that tug of war. So they get a little more pull to these extreme values when they come out. So with smaller sample sizes, you'll see a larger standard deviation. So, what we notice though is, with that small sample size, it's still bell-shaped, which is exactly what we want. So, through this example in number 3, it's important that our population data was normally distributed. That helped make it so that when we take any sample size, 25 or 5, even if I took a sample size of 2, we'd get a bell-shaped distribution out, and that it would basically mimic the population data. But what we want to be careful of is, what if the parent population is skewed? Or what if it's just not normally distributed? We can also look at what happens when it's just a weird distribution. How does that affect our distribution of means? So let's look at what happens when n is 2 versus when n is 25. So let's start with that small sample size. So I'm going to have a skewed distribution here, and I'm going to take a sample size of 2, and I'm just going to go ahead and collect a bunch of samples. So when a sample's collected here, it works under the idea that we have a high probability of getting these low values, and while we can get these higher values, there's a lower probability of those coming out. So with a small sample size, what we can see in our distribution of means is that it's skewed. And we do not want skewed distributions because we can't do anything with this. We can't calculate probabilities, we can't find out cutoff values, we just can't work with it. So having a small sample size with something with a population data that's not normally distributed, we can't work with that. However, if we bump up our sample size to 25, there's our nice bell-shaped distribution. And it's again that kind of idea of tug of war, that while we might get some extreme values, most of our values should be landing where we expect to, and it averages out. So they pull to where they should be landing, and we get a nice bell-shaped curve. Same thing would happen, the means would match up, standard deviation decreases because we're averaging things. So with a skewed distribution, then the distribution of means is skewed, and that's not good. But when we take a larger sample size, that distribution of means is normal, which is exactly what we want. So this just goes to show that we need large sample sizes, specifically when we have distributions that aren't normally distributed. So this brings us to the central limit theorem. It tells us some pieces that we need to have be true in order to work with these bell-shaped distributions. So looking at a distribution of means, we need to have independence so that when you grab your sample, the sample values aren't influencing each other. It should also be a random sample. If we're not choosing randomly, I think that kind of makes independence fall apart. And with the problems that we work on with those two, sometimes we just have to assume these are true. If they don't specifically state that it's random or specifically show that it's independent, we'll just kind of assume those. But the one that we absolutely have to make sure is true is the sample size condition. If our population's normally distributed, then we don't have to worry so much about this. So if our population is normal, we don't really need to have a large enough sample size. We could talk about sample sizes of 5 or 2. It's not great data, but if it's normal, there's no sample size condition. However, if it's not normal, then our general rule of thumb is that our sample size should be large enough, which our cutoff value is typically that our sample size should be larger than or equal to 30. As we saw from my examples today, we worked with a sample size of 25, and that came out nice and bell-shaped. 30 is kind of the number to be safe. As long as it's larger than 30, it will definitely be normally distributed. So this is just a little simulation about our distribution of means, how they're formed, why sample size makes a difference, why the structure of our population data makes a difference, and now we can go on to making calculations with these distributions.